Praise God, amen, hallelujah. We are the Victory Chapel, amen, located at 2320 Main Street, right here in the wonderful city of Bridgeport. We want to thank those that are here with us tonight, those that are joining us on live stream, amen. Why don't we rise to our feet, clap our hands, lift up our voices tonight as we sing that song. We want to see Jesus lifted high.
We want to see Jesus lifted high, a banner that flies across this land. That all men might see the truth and we wanna see Jesus lifted high. We wanna see Jesus lifted high. Step by step we're moving forward. Little by little we're taking ground. Every prayer a powerful weapon. Strongholds come tumbling down and down and down and down. We wanna see Jesus lifted high. A banner that flies across this land. That all men might see the truth and know that He is the way to heaven. We want to see Jesus lifted high, a banner that flies across this land. That all men might see the truth and know that He is the way to heaven. We want to see Jesus lifted high. We want to see Jesus lifted high. Step by step, we're moving forward. Little by little, we're taking ground. Every prayer, a powerful weapon. Strongholds come tumbling down and down and down and down. We want to see Jesus lifted high. A banner that flies across this land. That all men might see the truth and know that He is the way to heaven. We want to see Jesus lifted. A banner that flies across this land. That all men might see the truth and know that He is the way to heaven. We want to see Jesus lifted high. We want to see Jesus lifted high. Step by step we're moving forward. Little by little we're taking ground. Every prayer a powerful weapon. Strongholds come tumbling down and down and down. One last time. We want to see Jesus lifted high. A banner that flies across this land. That all men might see the truth and know that He is the way to heaven. We want to see Jesus lifted high. A banner that flies across this land. That all men might see.
Hallelujah. We're going to continue on this evening. Amen. Continue to glorify our King, our Jesus, as we sing that song, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Hallelujah.
King of Kings, Lord of Lords. We're going to shout it on the streets. He is Lord.
King of Kings.
King of Kings, Lord of Lords. We're going to shout it. Bow, every knee, every tongue.
Praise tonight. Father God, we give you praise and glory, God. Hallelujah. God is worthy to be praised, church. Let's continue on this evening as we slow it down just a bit. Let's lift up our voices, our hands to God. Amen. As we sing that song, Love Unfailing, Overtaking My Heart. Amen. Love Unfailing, Overtaking My Heart. I know that you called me. continue on this evening worshiping our Jesus as we sing our song, You Delivered Me From Darkness Into Light.
You delivered me from darkness unto light. You've given my soul abundant life. Majestic is your name. My lips shall sing your praise, and my heart will cry out loud and say,
worship our Jesus once again. Father God, we thank you, God. We give you all the praise, all the glory, God. We worship your holy throne. Amen, God. You are glorified in this place. Amen. Every service, amen, as we continue to pray, amen, for friends and family members that we know are in need, in desperate need of salvation, amen. We want to pray for them tonight. We want to lift up these names, believe God for a miracle. Amen. We want to pray, amen, for Steve Branford. Amen. I also want to pray for LaVon. I want to pray for Al Santos. I want to also lift up, amen, Vanessa and Jessica. I want to pray for Hector Torres. I want to pray for Michael Key and his family, Michael Fristina. I want to also, amen, lift up Will, Frankie Milagros, Miriam, Patrick, Caesar and his wife Shalima. I want to pray for Marcus. I want to continue to pray for the only family, Joseph, Joel, and Joy. Amen. I want to also lift up Omar and Angel Vasquez. Amen. Also Rich Solar and his brother Ed Solar. I want to also pray for Sean Melendez, Shemaya, Chichi, Pamela. I want to pray for Lisa Beth, Eddie. I also want to lift up Aaron for salvation. Believe God for an absolute miracle. Amen. For their lives. Also want to pray for David as well. Amen. Hallelujah. And also for healing tonight, I want to lift up our sister Marisol for healing upon her body. Amen. That God will give her strength and God will begin to heal her. Also want to lift up Brother Kevin. He's recovering from the surgeries. Amen. That God will bring complete healing upon his body. I want to also pray for David, a co-worker of mine. He needs healing upon his body as well. I want to pray for Caesar, Vanessa, Milagrosa, Hezekiah, and Viola Coca. I want to also pray for Magdalia Colon Diamond. I want to pray for Johan, Indio, and also Shemaya, and many others that we know are sick in body. They need healing. For special prayer requests, as we always do, we want to lift up our leadership church in the Bronx. My pastor, Pastor Viles, I want to pray for him, his wife, his marriage, his ministry, amen, that God will continue to cover him, cover his family. We want to also pray, amen, for our leaders, Pastor Greg Mitchell, Pastor Harold Warner, and also Pastor Suspansky, and the leaders of our fellowship, that God will continue to cover them, navigate them, amen, as they continue to lead our fellowship into a worldwide, amen, commission for Jesus Christ. I want to pray for marriages tonight. We need Jesus in our marriages. Praying for fruit for my outreaches. Praying as well for that God will continue to give us favor with our landlord for the building. Amen. That God will help us with that. We're praying for young people, teens, and singles that they'll continue to make a righteous stand, amen, against sin, and they'll be, continue to please God with their lives. Praying for good jobs for God's people, that, and that God will open up doors. Also praying, amen, for our churches that we have abroad, those churches that we have around Ukraine and Russia, that God will help them, that God will protect them as well. And also we're praying, amen, for our youth Bible studies, that God will continue to help us in that as well. And also we're praying for addicts, drunkards, game bangers, amen, to get saved, the broken homes, amen, to get healed. Also praying, amen, that God will help us tonight. I tell you what, we need the hand of God tonight to move. And even those that are watching online, that God will touch them in their state, in their place, and that God will give them a word in season. Let's lift up our voices tonight. Let's lift up every need before a holy God and believe God for what he has for us in this place. If you have any prayer requests, make it known before your Savior. His ears attentive to his people. And we want to ask God to help us in this service. Let's pray. Let's ask God to help us. Father God, we come before you tonight in the precious and the mighty name of Jesus Christ. God, we lift up this request to you, God. We pray for those that are in need of salvation right now, God, that you would soften their calloused hearts. God, that you would bring them to a place of repentance, that they would turn from sin, God, and they would begin to worship, honor, and glorify you. God, we pray for those that are sick in body right now, God, that you would bring healing by the precious blood of Jesus. God, we pray, God, for our young people, God. God, we're asking, God, for a supernatural encounter. God, we pray for backsliders to come back home. God, we lift up our leaders tonight, God, and we're asking, God, that you would move upon their hearts, cover them, God, continue to navigate them. God, we're asking even tonight in this service, God, that you would move in such a way, God. God, that we would find ourselves at the altar of God. God, we're asking for more of you. God, open the floodgates of heaven. Pour out your spirit and move. Even through live stream, God, move and convict, exhort. God, make well, God, and heal the brokenhearted. God, we believe you tonight, God, for all that you have for us. And we ask you, amen, we ask you for a visitation of your spirits. And we ask you this in the mighty name of Jesus. And God's people said, amen. Let's greet each other tonight. Hallelujah. first and foremost, want to welcome you after the Victory Chapel, amen, where Jesus Christ is truly changing lives, one precious soul at a time, amen. Very quickly, for way of announcements, we do have our youth Bible study tomorrow, 6 o'clock prayer, 6:30 Bible study, amen. And also, this Saturday, we will be heading out to Rhode Island to help, amen, Pastor Luna, amen, with an outreach team. We will be leaving here at 9 a.m. if you're planning on joining us. And we do ask that you come along and help us as we go out as an army of God and win souls in the name of Jesus with our sister church, amen, in Rhode Island. We're going to have a wonderful time. We'll be leaving here once again Saturday at 9 a.m. to get there on time for prayer. And we want to be a blessing to them. Sunday service, 10 o'clock prayer, 11 o'clock service, amen. And Sunday evening, 6 o'clock prayer, 7 o'clock service, hallelujah, amen. And also, we want to plan, I know it's a little bit of ways, maybe three weeks away, but we want to plan a church picnic on the 4th of July, amen. And the location is yet to be decided, but we want to, we want to gather together for that day, so we can plan that out. We'll get more details by Sunday out to you all. Amen. That's all we have very quickly for a way of announcements. Amen. We're going to receive the Lord's offering tonight. Amen. Very quickly, I was thinking about some things that I've noticed throughout the time of me working where I work at. I've noticed people have people complain about the wildest things when it comes to finances. And I began to think about how God's economy is not dictated by the world's economy. Yes, I think that this is pressure for a lot of people. And I understand that. And I'm not negating that these things that are happening in our society are real. Right, gas prices are up. We know that hurts us. For us, for those of you and like myself, we own a house that only has oil, and so of course, you know, to fill up that tank now cost about $1,600 to fill up the tank of oil so we can have heat and hot water. And so it's, I understand those things. I'm not negating that, right? What used to cost us, $50 for groceries now costs us $150 for groceries, right? We understand those things. But I do understand and I do know the power of God behind finances. That's what I do know as well. I do know that my wife and I, we just celebrated another birthday of being saved. Amen. It's 19 plus years being saved. Amen. And I tell you what, is it 20 years now? 20 years, amen. 20 years of salvation. Amen. She's one day older than me in salvation, amen. But I'm coming to you with the hope and the joy of telling you throughout the years, how many know there's been up and downs in our economy, but I have never really felt, my family has never felt those up and downs through God's economy. God has always allowed us to see his provision for our lives. And I want to tell you something. We've already started the construction. Where if you go out, don't use the first bathroom. We already started construction in the bathroom. We got so many things about that are going on, that are about to happen. And I want to stretch you a bit, church. I know not everyone's here. I get it. But there are many people looking on live stream. I want to stretch you a bit. Anything that you want in life, you have to work hard for. Anything worth having in life is worth fighting for. And when we think about what God has given each and every one of us the privilege to do, and that is to build his house, to build a place and prepare a place and establish a place where people can come and enter into the glory of God. We cannot be gripped by fear because of what the economy is going through. We cannot be gripped by fear because we hear people and their sob stories. You know how many people have come into my job and say, you know what, I can't fill up my motorcycle anymore. Or I can't fill up my boat. Or I can't go out to these expensive restaurants. Listen, prioritize your life. and watch how God moves because you're responsible. That's called being a steward of God's finances. Everything that we obtain in life is for the favor of God because he loves us and he trusts us with the things that he gives us. Church, let me tell you something. To knock down this wall and to, you know, buy 100 more chairs and to furnish the rest of the building, because I already believe God for a miracle and I need you to believe with me. I need you to trust with me. The word of God is sustainable. It has no flaws. He says, try me now in this and see if I'm going to open the floodgates of heaven. Write promotions on the line. Amen. Openings, waiting for opportunities. God doesn't just drop a bag of $1 million on you. No, he's going to want you to glorify his name through your life. Amen. Listen, when I began to give, I'm about to close with this thought. When I got saved, amen, my older son and I, we were talking about this. When I first got saved, amen, and I was working plumbing, before salvation, I was irresponsible, I wasn't trustworthy. But when I got saved, amen, my boss began to notice a tangible miracle in my life. Amen, he began to see that I got to work early. He began to see that I wasn't stealing his time anymore, that I was working to the time that I clocked out. He began to see that I began to want to do the right thing, and he began to notice that, and within 1 year, my salary tripled. It wasn't because I was doing anything out of the ordinary. I was doing what was right, finally, because now God had given me some sense of responsibility and righteousness in my life, and God honors righteousness. Amen. Let's be faithful, and let's trust God in his word, because we want to prepare for what's about to happen. Amen. We don't want to be like, the landlord comes and says, you know what, we have this ready for you. Let's make it happen. And I don't want to have my hands tied behind my back saying, you know what, God can't do it through his people. God can use us if we are willing to surrender to him and trust him at his word. We are not going by the world's economy because God's resources do not run out. Let's have us come up and receive this offering tonight. Amen. Father God, we count it an absolute privilege, and we thank you that you've given us the opportunity to give unto your kingdom, God. We pray, God, that you bless the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name, amen. Wait, what song is that again? Amen. The power of God.
The power of God is a mighty force to break the strength of the enemy. The power of God is a mighty force to break the strength of the enemy. His power is in us. He's working for us. The strength within us. Smashing on the plan of the enemy.
Power of God.
The power of God is a mighty force to break the strength of the enemy. The power of God is a mighty force to break the strength of the enemy. His power within us. He's working for us. Feel the strength within us. Smashing on the plans of the enemy. The power of God.
Amen. We appreciate that tonight. Amen. You can be seated. Hallelujah, amen. We serve a wonderful God. Yeah. Hallelujah. Before we begin, I just want to make a disclaimer. There are some decisions, Christian, that you're going to have to make in life that are going to hurt. And I'm not saying that they are going to hurt you. They're not going to hurt your walk with God, but they're going to hurt your heart. Jesus said in the word of God, I've come to bring division, the sword between righteousness and unrighteousness. And we're going to have to come into the reality of life that when God really does come first, people are not going to understand it. Amen. The title of our sermon tonight is called The Perfect Will of God. The Perfect Will of God. On October 31st, 1999, a full plane took off from JFK Airport in New York City on a routine flight to Cairo, Egypt. Shortly after takeoff, the relief first officer waited for the pilot to leave the cockpit. The disengaged the autopilot. He moved the throttle levers from cruise power to idle, cutting the engines, and the airplane began to pitch nose downward and then descended into a free fall. I want you to think about this. So now the pilot, one pilot left, amen, the other pilot that's in the cockpit began to nosedive the plane that was full of passengers. In the final moments before impact, the horrified pilot dashed back to his seat and battled the co-pilot for control of the plane. The pilot pulled back on his controls, desperate to bring the nose of the Boeing 767 up, while the suicidal first officer pushed his own controls forward to keep the jet diving. Egypt Air Flight 990 crashed into the Atlantic Ocean south of Nantucket, Nantucket, Mass. All 217 people aboard were killed. The battle in that airliner's cockpit is like the inner life of a Christian. Each day, we choose either to hijack control of our lives, plunging ourselves into sin, or to remain locked in the direction of God's will. Every single day, you're going to have to make a decision to serve Jesus Christ. When God is moving in a person's life, it is usually because they have allowed God to take control of it. They have let go and have allowed God to direct and guide their paths in the issues of everyday life, decisions and situations that need attending to, and etc. People need to come to the conclusion that God knows better than we do. Somebody say amen. We are all called to live like Christ and be examples of his enduring grace. And in that, beloved, we are called to be living sacrifices to God. A living sacrifice lives for God. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2 says this. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Heavenly Father, we come before you tonight, God, asking God for a supernatural encounter. God, open the eyes of our hearts, God, and help us to receive truth. God, help us, God, to be able to surrender our lives to you, God. Challenge your people out of love. Challenge them, God, out of a desperation to see them make it and for them to be vessels that you can work through. God, we are asking that we leave here changed from when we came in tonight. God, even those that are joining us online tonight, move upon their hearts, God, supernaturally, and have your way with us tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to first speak about misunderstood concept of living for God. Beloved, this is really a misunderstood concept of Christianity today, and that is being a living sacrifice. People take that and make it fit to what they believe sacrifice is to them, and then they give themselves a line not to cross. They make up their own. Connected with the idea of living sacrifice, this calls to mind priestly service. Spiritually speaking, our bodies are brought to God's altar every service. It is the best to see the body here as a reference to our entire being. Whatever we say about our spirit, our soul, our flesh, and mind, we know that they each live in our bodies. When we give the body to God, the soul and spirit go with it. Amen. Present your bodies means that God wants you, not just your work. You may do all kinds of work for God, but never give him your life. There are so many people that work in churches but don't live for God. The thinking of our age says that our body must tell the will what to do. But quite opposite, the Bible says that our will must bring the body into subjection. The body is a wonderful servant, but a terrible master. Keeping it at God's altar as a living sacrifice keeps the body where it should be. Beloved, being a living sacrifice is to simply surrender to God. That means I don't go based on how I feel. I don't go based on circumstances. I go based on the word of God. Amen. Living a sacrificial life to God is surrendering all to Him and leaving all up to Him. In our scripture this evening, we have Paul the apostle, a man of God, beseeching. In other words, he's begging the people by the mercy of God to present themselves as a living sacrifice to God. Not just a sacrifice, but a living sacrifice totally for God and God alone. Can you imagine the greatest missionary in the world, Apostle Paul, begging people, please surrender to God. Stop doing it your way. 1 Corinthians 6:13, meat's for the belly and the belly for meat. But God shall destroy both it and them. Now the body is not for fornication, but for the Lord and the Lord for the body. Think about this for a moment. He's living in a time where people are in gross sin. They're involved in all types of things. He's bringing this truth and saying, listen, when you surrender, all this will be done with. There were sacrifices of atonement and sacrifices of acknowledgement. Christ, who was once offered to bear the sins of many, is the only sacrifice of atonement. We understand that. But our persons and performances tendered to God through Christ, our priest, are as sacrifices of acknowledgement to honor God. In other words, the only way we can get to the Father is through the Son. He was the only one that we can get to the Father through is Jesus. That's atonement. And in that, what we do as Christians, noticing and understanding and falling into line, is that we serve God with all of our hearts and we acknowledge Him through our lives, how we speak, how we present ourselves, how we react, how we respond. All these things matter to God. How many people are not in service tonight because Christians haven't been living sacrifices? How many times have you heard, well, because of so-and-so, I don't go to church? Of course, we know that's not a reason. That's an excuse. But why give them excuses? We love God. We live for God. And God lives through us. And we surrender all to Him because He first surrendered Himself for us. And we look at what sacrifice may mean. And that, beloved, is to live as Christ did, holy and pure. Our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit. And in order for the Holy Spirit to live in and through us, we are to purge all the impurities out of us. You know, sin and holiness can't live in the same body. When people say, you know what, I hate the comments, you know, I got these demons living in me. You know, when I came to the altar and I repented before God, amen, and I made it right before God, God came into my heart. Jesus sits on the throne of my heart. How can I come and say, you know what, I'm fighting these demons? How can Jesus, who the demons fell down to and worshiped when He walked on the scene, how can they dwell in the same body Christ dwells in? You're either for God or you're not. In our scripture, 1 Corinthians, it reads for us that the body is not for fornication, but for the Lord. How many know fornication is running rampant today? They got apps for it now. Beloved, righteousness is expensive, and it will cost you. It is called sacrifice. We are to be living sacrifices, a living sacrifice that is inspired with the spiritual life of the soul. It is Christ living in the soul by faith that makes the body a living sacrifice. The sacrifice was to be slain, but you may be sacrificed and yet live on. And this is the joy of serving the God that we serve. God wants to adopt us as children to live as he wills and be examples of the Father in heaven by living according to his mercies. You know how many people I've heard? I kind of joke around to kind of bring the to kind of soften the sting a little bit, because I witness to a lot of guys at my job. And when I see them and they come in, and I'll grab a little dab of water and I'll put it right here in the eye, and it looks like it's dripping down. And he'll be like, hey, preacher, you got some water? I said, no, that's a tear. And they said, what's the tear for? I said, you weren't in church on Sunday. And I kind of mess with them a little bit. And they'll be like, oh, come on, stop making me feel bad. I said, yeah, we had to dust your seat off. My wife was asking what was wrong. And I'm telling them, you know, they're coming. But, you know, they after a while, they begin to notice. They come in, and now they're kind of embarrassed to come in a little bit. They don't want to come to my counter as much. Because the last conversation I have with people most of the time is the really deep one. That I look at them and say, listen, I'm really praying for you. I really want you to get saved. I really want you to come in. This is not cliche for me, buddy. I'm here, and I believe I'm only here for a season to reach you. And when they come in now, you have sin that walks through the door that now has to face a servant of God. And there should be an uncomfortability when you're a living sacrifice compared to someone that's a living sinner. The Bible says, be holy for I am holy. There is a relative holiness in every sacrifice as dedicated to God. Child of God, are you dedicated to him? That means when you're dedicated to God, you're not dedicated to anything else. Yes, there are things that are important in our lives. Listen, I've been married over 20 years. That's important to me. But I'm dedicated to Jesus. My wife loves me to death, but she's dedicated to Jesus. I remember the time, and I go back, I remember the time that I tried to play, I'm not going to church. And I remember very clearly my wife telling me, you go to hell by yourself. She was dedicated to Jesus, and she still is today. A living sacrifice. Not being deterred because of circumstances in our home, circumstances in our finances. We're not determining our salvation through that. A living sacrifice says, God only, and then you're the benefit of it. As they set apart the vessels in the tabernacle for the service of God, so we should also guard our members to be used for the service of the Lord. There's a problem. Too many people have been conformed by the world. My second point tonight is conforming to the world and not God. There was a comment that I made of the Bible, and someone that is a plumber, but he is an atheist. He tried to come at me with the word of God. But he texted me scriptures of the Old Testament. And I texted him back and I said, so-and-so, you know, I care about you, but you have to allow me to rebuttal your thoughts. And I began to text him back, and I wrote, I said, first, I want you to know that I'm praying for you to make it. But for someone that doesn't believe in God, you have a lot of nerve trying to quote the very scriptures you deny. Amen. And I began to give him scripture that rebuttals his thought process. And from then on, he has never said a word. Because you cannot speak against truth and still be sane in your mind. There is something that is uncomfortable there. Conforming to the world and not God. There is a great fear that humanity is going to fully reject the goodness of God. That humanity would allow their minds to be conformed to the acts of sin, and that their thoughts will become as minds of debased form and not carry the holiness of God and pursue God in their lives. This is so evident and it's scary. There is a warning of such things that were given in our Bible, beloved, that we are not to be conformed into the image of the world, but to the holiness of God. There's no way, you know, I've stopped looking at rap videos, Christian rap videos. I haven't looked at them for a while. Because I remember something my pastor told me years ago. He said, there's really no way someone can actually come into the presence of God and be the same. There has to be a tangible difference. And I remember years ago, he said, Pablo, I want you to look at this. And he showed me a Christian rap video. He said, turn off the volume. He said, what do you see? Can you tell the difference? Think about that for a minute. That had me thinking. There's no gangsters for Jesus. You're either saved or you're not. That's like saying I could be a fornicating Christian. That's like saying I could be an alcoholic Christian. There has to be a tangible difference in your life. Something that people can see and say they're saved. They have to be able to pick you up from the crowd and say you're not like the rest of them. Amen. In the summer of 386, that was a long time ago. AD, actually. A young man wept in the backyard of a friend. He knew his life of sin and rebellion against God left him empty and feeling dead. But he just couldn't find the strength to make a final real decision for Jesus Christ. Sounds like a lot of folks. And as he sat, he heard children playing a game, and they called out to each other these words, take up and read, take up and read. Thinking that God had a message for him, in the words of the children, he picked up a scroll, laying nearby, and began to read. Not in reveling and drunkenness, not in debauchery, and not in quarreling and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. Romans chapter 13, verse 13. He didn't read any further. He didn't have to. Through the power of God's word, Augustine gained the faith to give his whole life to Jesus Christ at that very moment. It's a decision. There's no confusion. Think about this. Heaven or hell? Heaven or hell? What's so hard? These are eternal destinations. Heaven or hell? People want to make it very difficult. Let's make it very simple. When you die, you're either going to be with Jesus for eternity or you're going to join Satan for eternity. There's no in between. Romans chapter 1, verse 21 through 32, a little lengthy, but God's going to help us. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, how many of you know some of those people? They became fools and changed the glory of God, changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image like corruptible man, and birds, and four-footed animals, and creepy things. Therefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness in the lust of their hearts, to dishonor their bodies among themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie, and worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this reason, God gave them up to vile passions, for even their women exchanged the natural use for what is against nature. Likewise, also the men, leaving the natural use of a woman, burning in their lust for one another, men with men committing what is shameful, and receiving in themselves the penalty of their error which was due. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to what? A debased mind, to do those things which are not fitting. Being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness. They are whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful, who knowing the righteousness judgment of God. The people of this world have conformed to this sad reality. And beloved, we are not to become as the replica of this world, but the offspring of God the Father. We are not to forget that God is long-suffering and merciful, and we are to have this mercy of God bring those who are falling to the spiral of the sin and hell and help them to get out and relate to this forgiveness of sin by the repentance. What I just read, we could all agree today, this is exactly what's happening in the world. And they're trying to be as loud as they want to be. The problem is not that man did not know God, but that he did know him, but yet refused to glorify him. Therefore, mankind is without excuse. Instead of glorifying God, amen, we transform our idea of him into forms and images more comfortable to our corrupt and darkened hearts. There are people that I know that they think they're so spiritual. They would come to me and be like, I believe in God. Look at the scripture I tattooed on my arm. What do I say? Right? How do I really explain to somebody that has been infiltrated with the lies through the word of God? How do I explain to them without having an argument? Because, you know, they want to debate with you and what they think is right, because they don't know the word of God. They just read one scripture and their whole life depends on that one scripture. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. That's everybody's favorite scripture. Everybody in the world knows that scripture. But the Bible also says that fornicators, liars, thieves, homosexuals, and all those that do those sin are not going to inherit the kingdom of God. See, yes, God loves people, but he hates sin. And God, being a good judge, has to judge sin for what it is. But think about this. There are those who say they love God but have not made their decision to live for him, but profess with their mouths. Jesus said they profess with their mouths, but what? Their hearts are far from me. Man's simple ingratitude against God is shocking. Think about this. I cannot say anything much worse of a man than that he is not thankful to those who have been his benefactors. And when you say that he is not thankful to God, you've said the worst thing about that person. Think about it for a second. Jesus laid down his life to see you and I go to heaven, and they're not thankful for that? That's the worst you can say about that man. Isaiah 29:13, therefore the Lord said, inasmuch as these people draw near with their mouths and honor me with their lips, but have removed their hearts far from me, and their fear toward me is not taught by the commandment of men. See, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, the Bible says. And yet people do not fear God. The world doesn't fear God. They don't fear the judgment that they're about to endure. They have no regard of the one who can save them from this horrible judgment, because they have conformed to the world and have no regard for God. Beloved, the world today has taken control of the plane, and they have begun to nosedive their lives into a pool of sin, leaving them to self-destruct when God wants to save them. But in order for God to save you, you have to let him take the wheel. You can't take control. You won't win. I want to lastly speak about transforming and renewing the perfect will of God. Jesus began his ministry by saying, repent. Now, a lot of people don't know that, but he did. In the Gospels, it says when Jesus began his ministry, repent. He invited sinful man to the redemption grace of God, even in their state. He saw the condition of man and said, I must give them a way out, and begin by saying, repent. You know what repent means? To turn your back on sin.
You don't do a 360. You know why? This is a 360. I'm back at the same place. You do a 180, you turn your back on sin, and you walk the other direction. In that repentance, we're going to experience a couple of things. There's going to be renewal, there's going to be transformation, and you're going to begin to fall into destiny. Renewing of the mind, beloved, our minds are to be cleansed by the blood of the Lamb. Conversion and sanctification are the renewing of the mind. A change not of the substance, but of the qualities of the soul. It is the same with making a new heart and a new spirit. There are new dispositions and new inclinations. New sympathies and new understandings are enlightened. Listen, you're not the same person you used to be. You think differently. Your conscience is softened. The thoughts are rectified. The will bow to the will of God. And the affections made spiritual and heavenly. You no longer dream about these sinful things anymore. Now you're wanting to please God. People come to you now and they say some horrible things. You don't laugh anymore. So you know what? That's not that funny. It's kind of gross if you ask me. The mind is the acting, ruling part of us. So that the renewing of the mind is the renewing of the whole person. For out of it are the issues of life. God doesn't want us to be the same, but renewed and changed. I wish I would have put the picture of how I used to look 20-something years ago. You would not notice. Got all gang signs up and all types of crazy stuff. But God changed me. He really did change me. 2 Corinthians 3:18, but we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. We have been formed and shaped by the world's view. Listen to me. Since we were babies, growing into toddlers and young kids and teenagers and adolescents, all these things, we've all had televisions at one time in our lives. And I'm just going to say this. I'm going to be honest with you. It takes generation to generation to generation to generation to change the outlook of things. I read almost 20 years ago that Disney was going to come out with a homosexual film. People didn't believe me. Not Disney. They would never do that. What are they doing now? It didn't start with what we see now. Some of you young folks don't remember this sitcom called Three's Company. Some of y'all remember that. You know, when the landlord would come in to this apartment where there was two females and a male, he would turn into a homosexual. That was little signals given out to the people looking at television. That must be okay. It's on television. This is what was filling our children, filling that generation so it can soften their conscience against God's law, against what God had called sin, saying that must be right. There was another show I remember called The Honeymooners. You would never see the bedroom because that was defiling the marriage. And every time you saw something, you saw the husband and wife, they made sure that people knew they were married because they kept high regard marriage. It went from that to 90210 to all types of Sin City. It went from G to rated X on television. And it took three generations to do that. I could imagine what the next generation is going to do. But this is what has happened. They have indoctrinated our children. They have indoctrinated every single generation. You ask a young person now about God, no regard for God. Who is God? They'll flip him off. Some of them will get you upset. You'll feel very disrespected because of their view on God. You know why? They indoctrinated them. Don't be fooled. This is the spiritual war. Don't think for one second that the teacher in school is for you, it's for your kids. No, they have an agenda. They have an agenda. The doctors that think that, you know, oh, I want to help you with your healthy child. No, they have an agenda. They're with it. Don't think for 1 second that they're for God. They're into science and medicine and changing all types of things around. You have to be mindful. And they've indoctrinated these children from birth to follow as the world spins round. These things are true today, and yet in our Bible, the Word of God speaks to us as being renewed and transformed into the image of God from glory to glory, no longer doing these the things that the way the world does, but how God wills and pleases for us to do. You know, God has a perfect will set up for us tonight. He really does. But the question is, will you be willing to come into what God has for you and allow God to renew your mind and transform your heart for His perfect will? That's the question. We all have grand ideas. We all have these wonderful plans. I get it. But are they God's plans? Micah chapter 6, verse 8, He has shown you, O man, what is good. What does the Lord require of you but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God? It is good. It is exactly the things that we need to do. It's good for us. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. And it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. You know, one thing I've noticed about people, they don't like being corrected. Amen, church. People don't like when someone comes and says, listen, that's not right. As opposed to taking it as, okay, you're trying to help me. What you're saying is, you think bad of me. Remember, the perfect will of God. It is acceptable and it is pleasing to God, which is prescribed by Him. The only way to attain His favor at the end is to conform to His will and His rule. There's no other way, church. It is perfect, to which nothing can be added. The revealed will of God is a sufficient rule of faith and practice containing all things which tend to the perfection of the man of God, to furnish us thoroughly for every good work. As I close, I'm going to close with this thought. Those who are best able to prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God are those who are transformed by the renewing of their mind. You know, living principles of grace are in the soul. As far as it prevails to be unbiased and unprejudiced judgment concerning the things of God. Listen, when you make a decision, I ask that you please rectify your mind that it is a righteous decision before the Word of God. Because if you make decisions based on what you feel, you'll damage the individual. You'll damage who you're trying to reach. But if you do what is right before God, it'll all work out. There was one gentleman that came to me today. He came to me with a situation at work. And he was very upset. He was very agitated. And I said, I can understand why you're agitated, but you always have to find out the whole story. You have to look at the whole thing. You know why? Because you know what I've learned with the Word of God? Is that you can take one scripture and you can determine a whole situation with one portion, with one line of scripture. But you never read the whole chapter. When you read the whole chapter, you begin to understand what that scripture means. Because people use scripture so wrong. They use it so wrong. And they manipulate people with scripture. But it's so wrong. Use the whole Word of God correctly, and there'll be peace among your life. Amen. Allow God to control the throttle of your life, and do not go for a nosedive to a sinful death, but be renewed and transformed to the life and image of Jesus Christ, and watch how God is glorified through your life. In the name of Jesus, amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed, and respect your neighbor, the perfect will of God tonight. Amen. You know, one of the things that I've noticed over the course of years, And you'll notice this too. The more and more you get in tuned, amen, to the will of God, the things of God, amen, you'll notice that the little sinful things that you've never noticed before, they'll become enlarged. Because now things matter. Now, every aspect of your life, you don't want it to be ruined by those little pebbles of sin that are trying to infiltrate your life. You begin to notice, and you begin to correct those areas, and people will begin to notice. But righteousness is very expensive. It's going to cost you. Righteousness is going to cost you. I've said this many, many times before. It's going to cost you some so-called friends. It's going to cost you some family members being upset at you. But it's also going to give you a peace with God, a peace all around you. People are going to be able to notice that nothing can shake you because you're founded on the rock. And in life, beloved, the perfect will of God is going to take for you and I to make a conscious decision to say, I'm not going to be moved. I'm not going to be shaken. I'm going to stand my ground because this is the perfect will of God. And you might be fighting some things in your heart tonight. Amen. You might go home tonight and there's chaos waiting for you. But if you walk on the truth and in the truth of God, nothing will shake you. You'll be able to enter into a place where there's nothing but chaos, and the Spirit of God, because of the righteous decisions you make, will flood that place, and all would have to be at peace because God is with you. And tonight is going to make sense. It's going to take some decisions. Maybe there's some things you need to correct in your life. I tell you right now, there are many things that I ask God, God, if there's anything in my life that is keeping me from growing with you, please expose it. Help me to grow, because I don't want to stay where I'm at with you. I want more. God has a whole bunch more to give you tonight. My first call tonight, amen. You might be backsliding in your heart, or maybe you're saying, you know what, even those online tonight, you say, you know what, Pastor, I'm not fully surrendered to God. I'm having that hard decision to make about being fully set for God. But let me tell you something. You don't have to. You can make the decision tonight saying, you know what, God, you only. And watch how things will begin to progress in your life, how you'll grow, how you come into the promises of God. And tonight you say, you know what, Pastor, that's me. I'm backsliding in my heart. I'm not right with God. I've fallen away from the grace of God, but I want to make it right. Amen. Would you lift your hand in this place tonight? Amen. Praise God. Saved and born again. Maybe you're online tonight. We're going to have a prayer up for you in a moment. Amen. Christian, you're here tonight, and I want to challenge you on being a living sacrifice. Being a living sacrifice is going to entail many things. It's going to entail for you for your prayer life to grow. You're reading to have a little bit more presence in your life. Having the knowledge of God set upon your heart. The Bible says be ready in season and out of season. It's going to take for you to love the people that are unlovable. It's going to take for you to make a stand for righteousness. Even in a place where people had seen you in your sin prior, but now you're making a stand for God. It's going to take for you to say no to sin and yes to righteousness. Listen. Being a living sacrifice means just that. And giving it all to God. And tonight you say, Pastor, you know what? This is what I'm going to do. Because you know what? We're in this together. We're going to build this church. We're going to build God's church. We're going to be vessels for His glory. And I want in. God will help you. But you're going to have to make that decision yourself. Amen. The altars are open. Come. Pray, lay a hold of God tonight. Ask God to fill you. God, give me confidence. God, I need that confidence to stand for righteousness, to stand and to speak truth and to do what is right and to do what is well before your sight. God, fill me tonight with your Spirit that I can stand when everyone else is chaotic around me. I can stand in your peace tonight and God will help you. Amen. Let's sing that song, As the Deer Panted for the Water.
As the deer panted for the water. our praise tonight, Father God. We worship you, O Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, there are, I don't know who it is. I'm not going to ask for you to come on up. But I will say this. You know, the mind battles because of the circumstances in your life, I know they're real. And I know that they can sometimes have an effect on your walk with God. But the song that we just sang, think about the words, you alone are my strength and my shield. The Bible speaks about the enemy shooting fiery darts. Those fiery darts can come from so many places, places we thought they would never come from. But you alone are my strength and my shield, God. And if we trust in what we see, we don't just sing because, you know what, we just want to sound good. Those words mean something. They mean a lot. Because he really is your strength and your shield. In your times of uncertainty, in your times of not knowing why things are happening, in your times of feeling defeated, in your times of feeling unloved or unwanted, whatever the circumstance, you alone, God, are my strength and my shield. You must trust in that. Trust in the word of God. Hold on to that truth, because that truth is real. And God is going to help you. Amen. We do have our youth Bible studies tomorrow. And also, amen, on Saturday, we're going to be leaving at 9 o'clock to Rhode Island. Coming out for that, if you're going to Rhode Island, please let us know so we can have a count for Pastor Luna. And we're going to have a wonderful time in Jesus. We thank you for being here tonight. Go out in victory, church, in victory, that God is going before us. Amen. Hallelujah. Father God, we thank you tonight, God, for your grace, your mercy, God, for speaking to us, challenging us, God, equipping us, God, giving us the faith we need to go on, God. Go before us. God, keep us safe, God, as we travel home, God, and get us back safely. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Be blessed tonight, church. Hallelujah.